Welcome at the last session of DML. Which is the panel discussion? The basic topic is how to go towards DML. I would start by introducing the panelists who are chosen from wide spectrum of national digitization project, and there are representatives of publishers, and there is a Sergeant Ball as CIC chair, which is Committee for Electronic Information and Communication within EMU, and he serves as a president of EMU. Numdam Bos, Pierre Bush, as already has been presenting and already know him, will represent Numdam and Suran, the most known and most complete digitization collections and projects that serve both Bond Digital and electro digitization stuff, and it's kind of model how that may work in the future with the moving goals. Žarko Mijailovic just presented what was done in Serbia. Just one example of national digitization, say, project. Masakazu Suzuki participated in several digitization projects where he helped with his NFT OCR program. Yuzi represents DMLCZ. Enrik Macias Virgos from University of Santiago de Compostela represents Spanish DML, which is up and running and has a lot of stuff there with Spanish mathematics. Wolfram Sperber is a representative of Central Batmas, one of the two interactive databases. He is here instead of Bernd Wegner, chief editor-in-chief of Centralblatt, and Katarzyna Zamlinska represents Polish Virtual Library of Mathematics. So these are the panelists. I am sure all other, or most of other, will something to say. I have in the call for papers post four questions that may or they should be answered on the way towards the dream of WDML. It's clear that we should unify in some way, at least on the portal, so that the individual project should from individual project we should input at least metadata or full text data, so that that can be dealt with in one portal. What has been already presented, a view that what's the most serious thing is the copyright and IPR issues, and what business model may work, because commercial publishers rushed for digitization of back files, and they are selling big part of the digitized math, and how to deal with this kind of stuff, business models, copyrights, and what may work in the future so that scholars may actually have one-stop shop for the digital mathematics. So is there any, if any, model for of sustainable interoperable and extensible mathematical library? Well, one way perhaps which is ongoing is bottom up from the smaller project like Czech DML or others, and then via UDML or Euclid and others to join in some future WDML. And from what has been done so far, we may try to come up at the end of the day with the best practices, what should be avoided and what should be supported doing during digitization project, basically for these three areas, retrodigitized mathematics when it's one goes from images via OCR, retroborn digital mathematics where we already have some form, electronic form of the paper, but it should be converted to some more exploitable formats, and more digital mathematics, which is a way the CEDRAM has been presented in the morning, where the metadata and everything needed is created as a side effect during the actual print journal production. So I would start asking the panelists on reflections of those questions, how they were dealt with in their project and expertise, and what they see as a main topics towards WDML. So please.
I think you probably have to point to one individual.
Yes.
Preferably that there.
So maybe John, or the CIC?
Oh, well, I'm the least expert, of course. Well, because on question two, so maybe I could say that I've just taken over as chair of CIC, and there are two other members of CIC here, Mike Doob and James Davenport. Mike is a continuing member, and James has just been appointed. So there's been quite a big renewal of the committee, and so I'm certainly interested in any comments that you have as to what CIC and IMU can do to further this enterprise. Now, IMU's not a rich organization. It can't fund digitization projects, for example. So that's the bad news. On the other hand, we have some expertise on our committee and access to a lot of the other expertise in this room, for example. And the one thing we do have is influence at some level, at least within the mathematical community. And we've done a couple of things like this best practices document on retrodigitization and connected with the registries, sort of building on the work of Ulf Raymond, who's on the committee, and John Ewing has just left it, in fact, for the AMS, and we've acted as a very powerful, well, as a very fervent, if you like, advocate for the whole project. Unfortunately, one of the main things we advocated was this moving wall model, which has been taken up by some mathematical organisations, but unfortunately not all mathematical organisations. For example, not the London Mathematical Society, since we're in Britain, and in some sense the commercial publishers, as you already mentioned, have realized that there's a lot of money in these backgrounds, and so they're going to continue to sell them, and I don't see the the tactic which can get them to change their mind.
Maybe they actually are hurrying up to offer their content to Google, because Google generates 3/4 of the traffic, for instance, for Spring Link. So they are eager even to give the full text to Google so that they have the traffic generated to their site. So,
Well, this was the original argument that IMU used to try and persuade them to but I mean, of course, it's a question of getting the access all the time. It's not, we only get a little from Google.
So the content is given to Google for indexing, and the traffic is generated for to their paid content, but that
it's still a valuable financial resource for them. It seems, unfortunately.
Yeah, but perhaps for one-stop shop, or for a mathematician, center point where everything is there, but links to open or close stuff might be solution in the future. What others think?
I wonder if there is a possibility to do it just step by step. That means to negotiate title by title slowly, and to get to increase the amount of journals which will get this moving wall. Maybe after some time the publishers will not be interested anymore, and they will definitely not be interested in it anymore, because that's a passion. Today everything is digitized, so everybody is interested to look back. In the past, nobody, only few people were interested to look in these shelves in libraries where they never went back. Today, it's so easy to access, so everybody is excited. It's so easy to see what was published 50 years ago and so on. But I think this is a kind of fashion. It will pass away after some time. And then there will be the danger, because the publishers will not carry the archives anymore. So we have to do it anyway.
I see that their strategy is to collect the journals in bigger and bigger collection and have them available and selling them in blocks.
We should do the same, and we need more cooperation. And I would ask Thierry to give an overview about our proposal of EU Digital Mathematics Library, of this project. I think this is an initiative to develop some power.
Yes, it's very difficult for me to give an overview. I think my point of view on these questions, I have tried to make it public in many occasions, is that we should develop a library just to get working the library function in this field. And it's the fact that it's digital finally doesn't change so many things. It's not because it's digital that the publisher should hold their journals issues 20 or 20 years old. I mean, it's their work is to output things, new things, to select and to sell the new material, not to hold it for eternity. And you cannot ask a commercial entity to do that reliably on the long term. We have seen that in the process of doing NumDum, for instance, because very often you cannot simply find the paper collections. The publishers have absolutely no back files of their paper collection because they don't care. They were sold, bought by other publishers, etc., and nobody cared for the back files. And so I think it's not publishers' work. Publishers' work is to create content, creates money out of this new content. And of course, now digitizing is creating a new content,
yes,
in a new format. And it creates a product, and there is demand for this product because librarians have had this fight with publishers about big deals, etc. And they try to counter the publishers who force them into eternal subscription. So they say, okay, but if I buy this volume in electronic format, I want access for eternity. And so the answer from the publishers is finally to sell it for eternity, the whole back run and the whole run of journal. But I think it can't work. I suppose that similar things happened at the beginning of the journal system in the paper world, where publishers, even recently, I mean, there have been a tentative to ask to license the use of books at libraries, so that when you loan the book, you should pay a fee to the publisher or to the rights owner. And this can't work, I think. So, but this, I don't see any incentive as what you said with Google. I mean, if we effectively build a one-stop shop where everything old is actually there, is referenced and moreover present, then the offer, the back volume offer of Springer or Elsevier has no reason. Mm. I mean, what will we get? We will get some links for if they play the game to and they transfer the new content with a moving wall so that we only refer to them. It's more or less what is happening currently in NUMDAM. The current situation in NUMDAM is that we got more than the critical mass. We now have all the living mathematical journals except two, maybe. Well, two important ones are missing. These are those owned by Elsevier. Well, and even that is not obvious. We have them, and we asked publishers to contribute their new content. We had strong discussions in some cases, and we had negative answers. And now we have got to the point where the last publisher that didn't want to provide its new content came to me and proposed it. And they are a partner of this UDML project as an example of publisher creating a workflow to archive its content in the library. So I think, but the picture is complex. Mm. So yes, we can. What we can do is, I think this is the notion of local libraries. We can have small entities that are near to the content, which have good reasons to take care of this content. It can be a mathematical society. It could be mathematical societies. I mean, it could be the best bodies to be responsible for that. But then there is a problem with money. But for instance, in France, NUMDAM is representing, in some sense, the mathematical community, and so we had good reasons to ask for the mathematical content published in France, and we had 5 journals, then 6 journals, then 20 journals, and now they want to be in. If there is one single publisher who is left aside, he is feeling bad.
So you get even full text from the commercial publisher?
No. Yes. The situation is it's written in my paper. For Elsevier, we get Elsevier was the first commercial publisher that agreed to transfer its content. We got everything post digitization from Elsevier. We got the PDFs, full text PDF, and full metadata. Including the bibliographies. There was a gray area with bibliographies, we have it. But we don't have the full text in TeX or in XML files. So we get that. And it's currently on NUMDAM, you have everything up to 2006, and 2007 is done but not yet posted. Right. For Springer, which was harder to get an agreement with, we got exactly the same thing. And I have currently, an, well, it has been, we had last week on our test server, everything from for Springer. Springer is one journal for us. It's just publication DHS, which is not the the smallest, the less important journal. But, from 2001 to 2007, we have all the PDFs and all the metadata. Metadata only, but all the metadata we need to run NumLab. And from EDP Science, which publishes all the applied math journals in France, from the Mathematical Society, the applied math, SMAI, we got also everything, but they are everything. I mean, we got the text sources from the when they have it up to now. The agreement is with Moving World. We archive this when they can provide it. In fact, in the case of Springer, we are considered as a consumer, and we, as soon as they publish an issue, now we get it. And we expose the metadata almost in real time, except the real time is 2006. And this generates links to them, of course. We expose the metadata, and we provide with DOI a link to their site, but only for new material. And the everything that is freed from the moving wall, our local PDF becomes available. So that's the model I have been advocating for since 2 years or more. And it's successful in the sense that it's now working with the publisher. But all there is no contract signed. I mean, it's agreements. Mm-hmm. It's like our IPR policies, and it's agreements. It's very fragile. At any time, it can be revoked, or I don't know. Mm-hmm. And nobody knows. I mean, they will look at their... If they realize that nobody buys their back content, etc. I mean, but we are on completely different scales. For Springer, we are one journal. They are making good friends in France by doing one, giving a very small part of their content for one journal. So maybe it's a good deal for them. If we were to archive all mathematical journals from Springer, maybe things would be much more difficult.
Yeah, so that's, I think, good news.
No, in Spain we are having similar problems with Springer, because we have digitized 13 journals, more or less 80,000 pages. And all the journals in Spain were from not commercial publishers. So all the journals agreed to participate in our project. But in the last moment, two journals from the Society of Statistics signed an agreement with Springer, because they enter in the ISI list of Thomson, and so Springer proposed a good contract, and so they refused to be digitized. But the curious thing was that in Spain, usually journals have two different periods: one before the 80s, which the journals were not so interesting, and after the 80s. And so they agreed to be digitized before the 80s, but not after.
Yeah, public money is for bad things. It's always the same. If you can make money.
Finally, for me, the problem was with the journals, not with Springer, because they signed a contract without reflecting the consequences. And so I think that the important point in your list is the point two, which is not there. That is, to give support to the non-commercial journals, to give legal advice, because if not, they do not know what to do. And when Springer comes with a proposal, they sign without knowing the consequences. And in this case, for instance, it would be possible to agree with Springer that the new issues have some conditions, but the older not, and not to sign all the collection. This kind of things must be a rule.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Michael?
Let me try to say something a little bit provocative here, maybe. When I hear digitization, I understand something completely different from you. Digitization for me means not just images, and I know it's not completely true, not just metadata. So
that's right.
I think both of these things are really, really boring. We have known how to do this with pen and paper for hundreds of years. And when I hear digital, it should be something more. We should have something where we have more services than just, well, producing images cheaper and getting images of math across the globe cheaper and faster. That I consider to be boring. I think that instead of doing what you people are doing, is broaden getting images of math somewhere cheaper, doing something deeper, and I have to exclude Suzuki from that probably, but doing something deeper which allows us to get more services out that we couldn't before. I mean, if I can read it, it's just basically what I can do with paper thing anyway. But semantic search, proof checking, or all these exciting other things, then we would see that almost all of these 10 million pages of mathematics that have been around for 2,000 years, of those maybe 100,000 are still relevant. Most of the published math, I think, is irrelevant by now. And for the 100,000 that are still relevant and interesting, I think we can get our grad students to retype them and own the copyrights. It shouldn't be a big problem, right? And they would learn something in the process. So I would say what you're doing is completely mistaken, even though I'm very fascinated by what you're doing.
I'd like to say some words in this direction. Our mission of this workshop, for example, is some kind of connection between mathematical knowledge management and existing data library or the existing mathematics. So, data library, we hope that data library open make some fields for future researchers of mathematical knowledge management to deal with real mathematical content, and so in this direction, the importance is the content of mathematical papers, and in this connection, I would like to introduce some a new trial. It is going on in American Physical Society of American Society of Physics. They are making their physical letter paper for all new volumes. They decided to make an accessible version of journals. That means accessibility means accessibility for all people. It means usually for blind people. And accessibility for my accessibility is for all people. It means accessibility. It is accessible to computers. So they are going to make accessible version of physical letter. It is a DAISY format. DAISY is some kind of special format of with including text data and speech data, or some you can include it into braille data. to synchronize. So so it is accessible. So so it in that paper in that volumes, they decided to use for to MathML for mathematics expressions, since in the accessibility technology, the MathML is very important, playing a very important role, since in Braille format, for us Braille math expression is universal, but in Braille notations, each country has different notations of mathematics, so to get Braille notation, they need some standard format for math expressions, and accessibility the people who are working on accessibility technology uses usually MathML as a standard format, and then convert it the content into various Braille notations, and also to speech output. All the basic is basis is MathML. So this can be some model of for us to future digital library of scientific content. We can say to the government that all the publishing should be accessible. So you should give some funds to do that. So and if we can you can get some funds for mathematical contents, mathematical libraries, to make them accessible, it means it is accessible to computers for future mathematical knowledge management engineers or researchers. Mathematical digital for the people. So the people who are working on mathematical digital library. I hope that you should take into account the accessibility of the journals.
I think it's not contradicting current status quo. For instance, this Czech DML, we are just waiting MathML entity having robust MathML output, so that we then batch run what we have and add MathML layer to the PDFs. And even for PDFs, there is TV Raman working for Adobe, having Adobe Access that allows actually reading the PDF.
Another thing I want to say. Yes.
I think is just thrown out of our attention, and it's just a matter of time when technology is mature enough, we run our stuff through the robust programs and get what is needed for.
What I want to say is that currently all the publishing of digital document is converged to PDF. But PDF is not good for future digital content, I think. So it is too difficult to analyze. Volker knows.
it's very it's difficult. It's converging to PDF. It's converging to XML.
So, of course. So,
the publisher has the primary source in XML. All the biomedical domain has agreed on the DTD for midline, and they pass the critical mass, so that every biophysics journal wants to be part of the midline, and they are eager to provide the
XML for them in that format, and the NSF funded the development of tools that goes from this XML towards PDF and whatever.
Yes.
And so in the very sense, it's 10 times bigger market than mathematics. So the Medline has 650,000 papers per year, new stuff. And it does work. It's XML. They convert to PDF, they make printed version, and that's it. And Kava is working for Elsevier. They provide the XML as well.
Yeah.
And today, Elsevier has announced a grant challenge that takes that offers researchers half a million research papers in XML, so that the development of algorithms that based on semantic they measure similarity and that stuff is possible. So I wouldn't say that PDF all everybody is concentrating on PDF. It's just most common delivery format, but I think everything in Dan Sebran is converted to XML.
No,
as an archive format. Input format is different. It's
no, currently we don't do full text in XML. That's what I said this morning.
Yeah.
We are not able to get full. In my view, the work on Celeron, especially with Stradix, should now provide some accessible version of the navigation items. I mean, the records, the abstracts, titles, etc. The website should be much more accessible, and it's entirely in mathematics. XML and mathematics, everything. So I suppose that it's more accessible. But the PDF, even when you say that publishers use XML, now I can see, I have seen the XML from Springer. In fact, it's there are lots of snippets which are of tech code in C data structure. So is it XML? It is XML. Everything is. I can put my whole tech file inside and a C data structure and say, okay, I'm completely XML, and now everybody is happy with what I do.
It depends on the it depends on the publisher.
Yes.
Yeah. That's a bad DTD.
No, that's a good, that's a way of doing things. I mean,
you that's a DTD that allows tech. It shouldn't. They should.
Yes, but the other way around is, in some sense, you are more semantic when you have tech code than when you have presentation mathematics. This was demonstrated by TV Raman in Minneapolis very well. You can say things in tech because you can create macros saying new things when you are doing research in math. And you can create the macro whose structure reflects the semantics. And in presentation mathematics, you will just say, okay, it looks like that. You can discuss that.
Yes, after implementation in XML, you may have the tech code as well.
So yes, you can have multiple streams for everything. This is the hell of mathematical publishing and mathematical text, is that there is no matter format. There is no abstract version from which you deduce everything you want to do. You want to do deduction, automatic deduction, you want to print, you want to understand, you want to put it...
No, there are such formats.
But for very restricted...
So, that's what MKM tries to do.
Yeah, you have to restrict...
It's very difficult to get that in the large scale. We can do it in the small scale.
I would even go as far as saying that there are some mathematical constructs which are published for which it's not obvious how you could say what it is saying in an abstract way. I mean, the mathematicians sometimes only use figures or diagrams, and it's I'm not always sure that it is saying something. But I'm it's not.
I would say that concerning semantics, this is probably the most interesting thing that was mentioned today. But when we are looking for something, we are looking for some specific topic, how to find it, okay? I think three things are there important for even a little bit more. We are talking too much about publishers and so on. I think it's we don't have a lot of influence on that, so probably it's, it shouldn't be at all a topic at all. Let us turn to that question. Look, semantics of some paper or something is best described by metadata, I would say. What should it include? Not only the title, but also keywords, then subject classification, abstract. That thing really defines the content of the paper, what you're looking for that. So, that's true. And so probably there is the fourth thing, what we are trying to do in our approach. Now we are also writing review papers about some books and so on, you know. So you really do not need to read the whole book, you can read just a review of it. And in short, you can find it. But what is the most important thing about digitization? The first thing, that it is really accessible to you. If it is, that's the first thing. If it is not digitized, then it doesn't exist. If it is digitized and put on the internet, you can find it. So it's much better to have it than not to have it, okay? That's the first thing. But the second thing is, okay, a lot of other, okay, data that I mentioned just now.
Yes, there is no conflict. I mean, you must have digitized first. You must have the images in order to do things on top of
that. That's the first thing. You don't have it.
You have graduate students or slaves first, and then you don't need the images.
You never get the 100% accuracy that with the retyping, you always get error.
Okay. Let me tell you something.
You can even fix typos. I don't know if you want
that. We really did. Okay, up to 1980. Since 1980, for almost 15 years, we retyped the whole publication or this journal that I mentioned over there. So it's a 30 volumes we retyped it in tech. And it was not really valuable. A lot of money, and it costed, for example, at that time, almost 1,000 euros to retype the whole volume. It cost. Now it costs 10 euros only, or $10. Just make a photocopy of it in any photocopy shop and put in this automatic feeder for scanning, and that's all. You're done in a half an hour. Why to retype everything? Even if you want to recognize, I think it's not really worth at all, not much worth doing OCR in mathematics. If you have good metadata, you can find everything you want. What you're looking for in the whole text, then it's much better take and read it. Why to recognize it? It's a very simple thing. I don't
they
understand
can't
it.
Agree.
They
don't read it.
It's very simple. If you're interested in something, then you should read it.
Michael has much bigger ambitions. It may not be known. He's president of Open Math Society, if I'm not mistaken, which is a format of mathematics that's a semantic one from which you may actually generate what's needed, and you may use for deduction and that stuff. So these ambitions are much higher than ours so far, if I understand it in a way. So, but the problem with his approach is that no publisher will use it unless it will pay back, and it pays back only the marginally, not repaying the costs of disambiguation on and semantic tagging on the parameter. That's it, I think. So we may have to wait until we have good disambiguation tools for going from the scans, from the images, via the text content via disambiguating the tagging, via going...
Or if we have good editors. I mean, the author usually kind of knows what he or she is talking about. So why go via images? I can see it for the back files, but we have good tools that make people want to use semantics. For instance, semantic search engines that actually find your theorems. I mean, I do math to have it used by other people because... So if we can guarantee that people will get a higher citation rate by using OpenMath or MathML or whatever, they'll just be willing to actually generate papers in that way.
Well, if you are able to show that they really get higher impact, they will do, but they will get only marginal increase.
Peter.
Who did the person with the first fax machine send the fax to? I mean, you can't prove that you'll get more citations with unless this happens. But I would like to make, correct one misimpression about being able to have less semantics in the MathML than in the tag. In fact, in MathML, in every symbol, on every node, you can put an annotation saying, what does this mean?
Mm-hmm.
And with tech, once either you're using macros and you can't see what it is, you have to load the extra macro packages. Once it's expanded, it's all gone. With MathML, there's a place to annotate every single symbol to say, where is its definition? What does it mean? And in fact, good math tech to MathML converters, even the one at Orca, will give you an annotation, the possibility to annotate every single piece of MathML with what its meaning is. So I think that it's important not to have a misimpression that even flat MathML that doesn't require XSLT can be sufficiently annotated so that all semantics are conserved. And then it becomes useful for searching and for the kinds of things that Michael was talking about and what you'd like.
Okay.
And concerning citation, the best way, you know, is you write, you should write good paper.
It's the best way to have impact is to write good mathematics. I'm afraid. I hope it will remain.
No technology can help that, I think.
Another thing is you may write your own paper and then everybody will discuss it.
Go wrong.
Well, that's a good paper by its definition.
Okay. Could I just pick up on a couple of points you made? The first one was you made that if your graduate student retyped the papers, then that will get you out of the copyright problem. Now, I'm not a copyright lawyer, but all my advice has been that it's a minefield, and that might be the case in some countries, but in many countries it's not the case. Of course, what's illegal and what will get you into trouble are two different things. So you can try and do something which is illegal and hope that the penalty is not too good, of course, but that was one point.
The beauty of the graduate student approach is that they can actually think while typing. And I think...
But they wouldn't be just retyping.
The problem is just one fringe benefit. I think the other big benefit is that you can actually rethink what you're doing. Because the original paper, great as it may have been at that time, is something we can probably, and that's what mathematicians are doing all the time, say better nowadays.
Yeah, but I think what you're saying is showing the value of this old literature. And when I've gone back to the papers early 19th century, but often the French papers actually, I've been amazed what I've seen there, and what hasn't been picked up by the modern literature, because people don't go back in general to read the original papers. And we've all seen these graphs of statistics of the number of citations per typical article. That's more or less linear back to the 1940s. Right, my feeling is that with a really good searchable index, which could you'd rediscover huge amounts of lost mathematics. I'm all in favour of this project.
Julie raised a very, very worrying point as to what if the publishers decide they don't want to keep their archives any longer. And John has pointed out that the graphs for mathematical citations show from going back a long way, but that is in many ways exceptional for mathematics. And as has been pointed out, we are actually comparatively small beer. 10 to 12 that is 1/10 the size of Medline. So one threat we have to worry about as a community is that because the old medical journals are not worth keeping, the same logic in inverted commas will be applied to mathematics journals.
The library world has been worried about that since they started digitizing things, and places like the California Digital Library has become a repository, and they worked out the legalities with publishers like Elsevier and Springer, and if they're like doomsday repositories. Nobody can access them right now, but if the real repository goes away, then boom, it's online right away. So they're set up for either the publisher decide backing out of keeping the things anymore, or for natural disasters where servers get killed in some way.
Who pays for that?
I'm not sure where the funding comes from, but I know that the University of California group is doing some of that, and it might be that they're funding it themselves.
That's actually how it is in Holland, I hear.
Yeah. There's more than just one.
Mm-hmm. And what format are they? They're just getting the data raw from the
I don't know the details. I just know that I've talked about it at meetings with people, and I don't know all the details.
Mm-hmm. Comforting.
I have one interesting question. You probably know that there are some Russian hackers with thousands of digitized books, you know. It's very easily accessible, really even tens of thousands, I think, yeah. So what to do with that? I think they're really digitized, the biggest digitizer in the world, you know. I don't know if you know about it. You know about it?
No.
No.
Textbooks, mostly textbooks.
Yeah, textbooks, a lot of, even very, very good scientific books, any kind of scientific book you can find on their sites over there. That's true, yeah. So what to do with that? This exists, you know.
Yeah.
Ultimately,
there's probably not very much you can do about it. I know the publisher of one of my books sort of went after a website and got it closed down. So it was unavailable for a few hours and then pop up. You know these games where you hit a
whack-a-mole,
yeah, where you hit this little gopher that comes out of a hole? Maybe that's just North American. But it's a game at the carnival where you hit there's a bunch of holes, and when a gopher, a little animal, comes up, you hit him on the head. Except another one pops out of another hole immediately before you can do anything. So this is the model. You know, you may see one and you may hit it, and another one pops up. And unless something really changes in the desire of governments to hit these gophers on the head, I think the answer is we can't do anything about it. Mm. That's the real answer.
Well, I think we should, on the contrary, encourage it. because it's going to we should give those people tools to do a good semantic job of it,
yes.
So that we have the resource.
Yes.
I mean, we should assign our students, because those are going to care about books we assign to our students, that they should buy them. So if we just take care to assign all the relevant books, then they'll be on these servers, which act as a great repository. So we should actually not whack them.
Well, I could give another side of the same coin. The same book that I'm talking about, the publishers went after, all three of us, the three authors, would be very happy just to release it to the world. You know, believe me, in research math books does not change your lifestyle, I promise you that. So, whatever grand amounts of money we were going to make, we've made already, and that didn't change our lifestyle. We're happy to just let the world have it. Okay,
except that you don't have the copyright.
But I don't have the copyright, yeah. So the other side of the coin is it's not 100% bad from the author's viewpoint.
Yeah.
So what I really wanted to say, there are a lot of really digitized books. Even there is some on Torrent, you probably heard about that.
Yeah.
Almost any kind of book you are looking for, you just put the name and you will get it. It's a very interesting one.
You know mathematical?
Yeah, yeah. Mathematical, just try. And you will see. It's very interesting.
The job is done.
The proceedings.
So
why are we?
So maybe we have our library, you know. We can all go home.
Just underground. Isn't it called RustDML or something like that?
No.
But maybe it's a bit late to open a can of worms, but at the risk of sounding a little bit naive, going from now on, I mean, talking about the legacy stuff, that's another story. I'm trying to work out why we need publishers at all. Am I being stupid here? Because the authors are around this room, the referees are around this room, all the best technology to converting this and that, we've heard that, you know, in a week Michael can fly from here to the moon or do whatever. Everything and why are we still having publishers? This is what I don't understand. From now on,
that's
it.
Well, one reason why you need publishers probably to have a legitimate feeling. As long as we can't convince, say, our vice chancellors and dean of sciences and what have you,
it's quite increasing.
There's a good paper in this public archive there, and that everybody agrees it's a good paper. It won't show up in any of the indexes, etc., etc. And you know your promotion prospects are probably not that high if you publish an archive instead of publishing somewhere that's bigger.
But isn't that what society publishers are for? Like ACM and London Mass Society and so on?
They're not better than the rest.
No,
they get corrupted.
I would like to say that I asked this question many times already, but there is.
Now I'm not the only one.
But in fact, we have to take into account that there is one reason why we need publishers at this moment. I mean, that's because we have to be sure that what was published is really the definite version. Whenever there will be just free space where everybody can post anything, how can we believe that this is really that one on which we can build the next theory?
Why should we do that? Because almost everything that's published is still wrong. Why shouldn't we have living documents? Why shouldn't we have living documents that at some point become correct? We just need a little bit more technology that actually helps us manage versions.
Okay.
It's called a wiki, it's called anything. I mean, and if we had a way of actually dealing with version, why should we just rubber stamp something and not keep improving it?
That assumes that the quality of an article in a living document is monotonically increasing. It may be getting worse. So what you get is the authority, once it's published by an authorized publisher, which is just somebody with a proper name who's selling enough journals that people will give it attention, you get some kind of authority to say, this actually is at least, we think, good enough.
But why don't we organize something better? Right? Why do we need Springer and Dead Trees for that?
Well,
so far
you can still stick with the old method of the traditional method of referees. I mean, referees work free for the publishers anyway. So they might as well work free for an open whatever. But I think there's a key thing in it, and I think Kavi is slightly wrong. This group is the people that write about writing mathematics rather than the people that write mathematics. and the people that that write mathematics instead of writing about mathematics are probably still stuck on, you know, it has to be that journal. And that's where you don't break away from.
But that, everything comes back to this sort of. It seems to be rather a weak reason.
It's a weak reason.
Even in mathematics, the annals of math is of even better reputation than in Venice. I mean, you don't have to be published by Springer. It's not a quality rate at all.
No.
So, but you have to have an authority.
And
you also have to have costs, because if everything is free in the publishing process, you tend to publish thousands of versions of the same app paper, and nobody can work with that. And I'm sorry, but I won't ever refer to a Wikipedia article, because I know that the version I will refer to can say something possibly better, possibly, but it won't be the one I read and I want to cite, and I can't trust it.
No, but you can have version citations. You would just say,
Wikipedia is versioned, and for instance, if you want to cite the version citation which contained an horrible bug, sometimes they remove it. Because
then they're doing it wrong. I mean, those are technical things and organizational things we can actually deal with. I'm sure we can.
I think the current publishing system is bad, I agree. But if I think it's a bit like democracy, since at the moment it's still the least bad of all the bad things. Now the problem with your solution of living documents and so on is, well, it's the Wikipedia problem that you end up not just having to read a large amount of stuff to be an expert in your field, but now you're going to version it.
To read it every day.
So you have to read so much stuff again and again and again, because it keeps changing, and you don't have any solid foundation to build your real theory and research. I agree, we need to look for something better, but Wikipedia is not better.
Not only, but even Wikipedia has its own editors.
Yeah.
It's not just free.
Yeah. Yeah.
There are some people who have the right, say, stop it. Now this one is the proper version. So it's a meta problem.
It always is. I mean, but I don't think that the real service is actually to rubber stamp a version. This is just an accident of a production process using dead trees that made this the way it was. And we're just getting too conservative and thinking that this is actually something good. It might be something good, but have we really thought about this? So I've just been involved in what the Connections people do. And they have this idea that we should have a content commons. And if there is no more scarce resource about publishing things, meaning dead trees or editorial boards or something like that, we should also switch from a pre-publication review system to a post-publication review system where somebody, where you just basically, like in Slashdot or so, you can publish anything. Whether it gets to anybody's attention is something completely different, meaning that you have some kind of a, they call it lenses system, that lets people invest their reputation, referees, that's what referees are doing, to actually raise things to the attention of people, which is exactly what people are doing. So we need less scarce resources and have a completely different thing, which might be more democratic, which might not. I'm not saying this better, but many of the things we are taking for granted actually aren't. And frankly, I'd rather change the future than I would change the past, because I think the most interesting things are going to appear in the future. So I think we should really think about these things. And the past is interesting, but the future is more interesting.
Yes? I have an example that summarizes the situation. The organizers of this Congress put in their web page an announcement in order to have the quality label that a paper about this Congress appeared in Nature, in the journal Nature. Yeah. And I accepted it there, and I had to pay £8 to read the news.
Here's the.
Why did you just the back of your program? we've copied it there.
Too late, no, too late.
It's late. I'm sure it's late.
But that is fair.
Yeah. So, anybody wants to have some final words?
I just want to say my heart just sank because I realized that I'm recording all this, putting it all on the web for everyone. And if Elsevier watched this, I'm in trouble because they're paying all my wages. So, I wasn't expressing an opinion. It was just to, to promote discussion.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So, okay. If it is known yet, Kaveh will publish all the recordings from DML on his reverbvalley.tv, so you may watch there today's lectures. Is that right?
Yeah.
Yeah, it will be there in some
a few days.
Yeah. I want to thank all of you who participated in the discussions, presented things, and work towards digital mathematics library.
Anyway.
I think we should thank Petra and everybody else who's contributed to this very nice workshop. Hmm. Even though I said you're doing it all wrong, it was still very interesting.
Thank you.